Welcome back to Low Budget Wrestling, brought to you from beautiful, sunny Youngstown, Ohio. The show is using experimental alien flux technology tonight to travel back to 1994 at the behest of Ukulele the Wanderer so that he can experience the heroes of yesteryear firsthand. Kinda didn't have any say in the matter, but we're here! And our general manager, Wifey Panic, has set us up with a one-night-only tournament with a $10,000 cash prize. 8 competitors will battle in one-on-one matches, and the tournament finals will be decided in a ladder match in our main event. In addition, our GM has signed our heavyweight champion, R. Sean Wells, to appear tonight to face a mystery opponent. Everybody good on that? Fantastic. Let's get started. So, let's get down to the ring for our first match of the night. Jim the Anvil Neidhart versus Big Hamm. Now, of course, you know, Big Hamm, one half of fantastic tag team American Sausage. They broke up a little while ago. Rip Sexton believed he was the bigger star. Big Hamm took exception to that. Now, nobody got kicked through a plate glass window. As you'd expect, a lot of tag teams to break up or hit in the back with a steel chair while their friend's still gawking in the ring. It was as amicable a breakup as you can really expect. So, you know, we've seen them tag together as recently as last week. The hatchet was buried, and Rip Sexton really took it upon himself to try to win that tag team match by himself without the use of Big Hamm, which, from this announcer's opinion, was a foolish decision. Because you're looking at a guy who's got the speed, the agility, the strength, like, just all these positives in Big Hamm, and you're not going to make use of that? When you were a tag team, you were fantastic, phenomenal. Yeah, like, just to the heights. Unfortunately, they broke up just before LBW was able to secure a weekly television show. But, you know, Big Hamm, you know, he's got a future of his own now. Separate from Rip Sexton, he is good. He's looking to make a name for himself. And this tournament is a fantastic way to do that. You get $10,000 seed money, buy you a lot of skull masks. Now, his opponent is Jim the Anvil Neidhart, the lesser of the Hart Foundation. I don't think anybody's going to disagree with me on that. In our time, he has a daughter, Natalia Neidhart, who routinely is credited as being the niece of Bret Hart rather than the daughter of Jim the Anvil Neidhart. So, you know, it's not like he's even the best half of the Hart Foundation tag team. Like, he's a hanger-on to the family. And Big Hamm taking exception, meeting Jim the Anvil Neidhart halfway up the ramp and just cuts the knee out from underneath him. They didn't even make it to the ring yet. Big Hamm not wasting any time. He's got places to be. Tucks him in over the shoulder, smashes that powerbomb shoulder breaker. Neidhart doesn't know what's going on. Big Hamm taking exception. Apparently there can only be so much pink in the ring. And Big Ham's owning the color scheme right now. He's circling. He's looking. Drops that knee across the forehead. Neidhart still hasn't made it to his feet. Mounted no offense so far. Good kick to the spine. Big Hamm up on the shoulders. What's he looking for here? Nothing good. I guarantee it's nothing good. Spins an F5 straight into the ground on the entrance ramp. The entrance ramp is the hardest part of the ramp, by the way. Trademark. Whipped into the guardrail. Their fans are getting a good front row seat. Big Hamm wraps those powerful thighs around the side of the head of Jim the Anvil Neidhart. Drops the elbow straight into that face. He ain't going to get any prettier. He's going to raise that ugly quotient a little bit. Powerbomb shoulder breaker again. I said, Neidhart's going home in a bag. See the duck under. Oh, look, he mounted a little bit of offense. Missed the clothesline. Came back with the other side. Neidhart's not going down without a fight. Good to get that punch caught. Get those eyes raked. Gets drawn in. Powerbombed outside the ring. We haven't even made it into the ring yet. Big Hamm might have finally had enough. He whips Neidhart toward the ring. Doesn't make it all the way there. He gets him inside that time. Slide in. Here, Hamada rings the bell. The match is officially started. Kick to the gut. Boom! Big Hamm lands the meat squasher. Let's take another look at that. It's a lifting vertical suplex flipped into a powerbomb. He calls it the meat squasher. And this beating has brought Bret Hart out to watch from the back, but pretty, I don't think there's anything else to see. Hamada down for the count, one. And Big Hamm, winner by decisive pinfall. Let's take a look at some of these highlights. Hey, what's there even to look at? The match literally, like, it's going in the books as maybe a 15-second contest. You're really only going to be able to see it from when he threw him in the ring. Bam, there's a meat squasher. And that's it. That's the only real contest of the entire match. Well, the only real content in the whole actual match was Big Hamm throwing Neidhart in the ring for the meat squasher and catching the quick pin. All the rest of that violence happened well before the bell actually rung. Big Hamm taking no prisoners. Big Hamm came back to 1994 to make a statement. And he made that statement directly in the face of Jim the Anvil Neidhart, at the expense of Jim the Anvil Neidhart, who he is not done with. So the match is over. Like, there's nothing else to gain here except an F5 to the face for Jim Neidhart. We gotta knock that stupid little beard back up in his chin. He cinches in the crossbar. Just get the man a tap for no reason. There's nothing here. What are you doing? Why are we doing this? I don't know, because it's awesome. I'll go with that. And hey, you know what? Just for funsies, here's an extra meat squasher. Get that meat squashed. Hiro Hamada ringing the bell. The match is already over. What else do you need? Yeah, that one Neidhart fan in the crowd going home sad tonight. Big Hamm is your winner. And in our second round matchup, we have Rowdy Randy Stan taking on Ricky the Dragon Steamboat. Randy Stan, he's the youngest competitor we have here in LBW. He's made a fantastic name for himself as one half of the tag team Equipo Leon Negro with his partner, the Great Prince Awesome. He has had a great run as a singles competitor as well. People tend to underestimate the guy constantly, and I, for one, don't understand why. He has standout wins against the likes of Bear Bradford. He went toe-to-toe with Arshon Wells in the heavyweight title tournament. Like, the man's he's a legitimate athlete. He's managed to fuse an interesting style for himself, combining his amateur wrestling background with a lot of the offense that he's gleaned from his mentor, the Great Prince Awesome, and also his hero, the late Eddie Guerrero, into this hybrid. It's a grounded aerial style that's really hard to combat. Ricky the Dragon Steamboat, a legend in other companies that don't really matter here, is going to have his work cut out for him tonight. Now, Ricky the Dragon Steamboat has had famous matchups with the Macho Man Randy Savage. He's been a former Intercontinental Champion. Tonight, he's going to face Rowdy Randy Stan, a young man hungry for adventure, for with an appetite for suplexes and arm drags. And we're going to see if the incredible small package finisher. I don't actually know what Ricky the Dragon Steamboat's finisher is. No one does. It's a mystery. No one knows how he wins. We just know that he does. He's got like an ill small package or like a nasty arm drag. Something going on there. He'll karate you up. So, that said, match two, $10,000 title, $10,000 tournament. Let's go. Say, Randy Sand lifting dropkick right into the face, starting off early. Gets a running dropkick to the side of the head. Randy Stan wasting no time, trying to keep the pace quick. Rolls him out, drops that elbow on the right in the chest, and heads outside the ring. What's he looking for out here? Oh, springboard off top rope, completely shoots wide on the dropkick. Dragon trying to take advantage, catches that popping dropkick again. Randy Stan goes for the cutter, gets it blocked, just answers with a couple of stiff right arms and a European uppercut. He's got him on the ropes, whips his man off, slides under, gets kicked in the side of the jaw. Say, Ricky Steamboat, nobody's fool. I say a little more grounded offense from the from our veteran competitor here. He's like, you know, you think Ricky Steamboat would want to keep the pace high, but I guess he knows the younger man has that advantage. He doesn't want to pull that card out just yet. Ricky counters the body slam into the Dragon Sleeper, brings him down with the DDT, misses the wild leg swing, gets drugged to the center of the ring, and Hurricanrana. Randy said, doesn't go for the cover. These two, it's too early for that. He doesn't even attempt it. It's a whip to the corner. Drop kick into the turnbuckle. Drops his man straight in his face, and Randy's got time to taunt for the crowd. It's a solid kick to the gut, and a European uppercut to the face. Picks him back up. This is going to be what's going to be here. Throws him into the opposite turnbuckle. Ricky Steamboat, kick to the mouth. Rich flying axe handle off the top rope. It's a Randy stand. The momentum is shifting. Randy counters the body slam into a nice back body drop. And again, more time for taunting. Yeah, it's important to let the crowd know that they're right there with you. It's a kick to the gut. Throws that arm over the shoulder. Lifting brain buster. So he stole that one from his mentor, the great Prince Awesome. Randy going to the top rope. Center of the ring. Nails the turning frog splash in midair. That's a short night for Ricky the Dragon Steamboat. But no, kick out at two. No one's more confused about this than Rowdy Randy Stan. But he's got to stay on his man. Use the momentum that he's got to this point. Lifting powerbomb straight into the pin. Shoulders are down. And it's not enough to put down Ricky the Dragon Steamboat. Dragon able to recover from the frog splash and then immediately gets powerbombed and gets away from that too. The teardrop suplex dropped him right on the back of his neck and his head. This is Randy. Randy's full offensive mode here. Not letting up at all. Whips his man to the outside. Shoulder block to the gut. Drops him outside to those thin ring mats we keep on the outside of the ring. Now, again, we're not really trying to protect the floor from our competitors. So we don't invest a ton in ring mats. Because, you know, that's just wasted money. We could spend that on fireworks or, you know, like a new beer pong table. Whatever you want. But it's not going to buy Randy Stan out of that elbow to the throat. So Ricky Steamboat goes to pick him up, gets arm drug over, repays it with a deep arm drag of his own, and smashes that left hand into the mat. Ricky must have figured out at this point that a lot of Randy Stan's offense involves lifting, with those lifting vertical suplexes. You take out the arms, you're going to remove a lot of the power. And he jumps off the top rope to the ground with the axe handle, hits not a goddamn thing. Why, Ricky? Why would you do something so foolish? All it did was get you powerbombed outside the ring onto the cold, unforgiving polystyrene. Randy Stan would be more than happy to take the count out win here. As our referee, Hiro Hamada, continues the count. Randy goes to the top rope. Gonna show him how it's done, Randy. Is that your game plan? Why? Why are they flying elbow off the top? Why would you try that? Why? There's so much at stake here. Clearly, these two dumb assholes don't understand. There is more tournament to fight, guys. It's too early in the night to take these kind of risks. You don't have to one-up each other. It's not necessary. Randy nails the brainbuster again. Thinks about it. Goes for a pin. Hooks the leg. Got the feet on the ropes. Woo. Ricky Steamboat able to get away from it. The Inzaghi takeover shuts that offensive plan down. Randy Stan climbs the top rope again. A lot of high-flying offense. Gets the point. Nails the turning senton drop. And no, it's not enough. It's not enough. Randy, what do you do? You pull out all the stops you knew how to do. He reaches over, gonna maybe change tactics. Go look for a submission win here. So he's gonna take that hamstring, try to stretch it out. He's grabbed the bottom of the foot. He's pulling it up to try to kick Ricky Dragon Steamboat in his face with his own leg. the stump puller submission. Randy goes for the enziguri again. Misses, throws the elbow to the face. Fisherman suplex, but doesn't have enough energy to go to hook the leg and go for the pin. He turns over the belly. One arm across the chest. It's enough. Ow, and Ricky the Dragon Steamboat gets that arm up. Saves himself. Ooh, the returning calf heel kick to the mouth. And it busts Ricky the Dragon Steamboat open. Randy Stan is feeling it. Dragon doesn't know where he is. Whoa, rolling those hips. Keeps the suplex locked. Roll him again. One amigo, two amigos. Can he land a third one? Three amigos, center of the ring. Ricky the Dragon Steamboat is in trouble. Randy Stan looking to finish this off. Nails a five-star frog splash. Give it an extra one. Call it a six. From halfway across the ring, crushes that man across the sternum. He's bleeding. He's got some amigos in him. And the frog splash is enough to secure the win. Randy Stan is your victor. Moving on to the second round of the tournament. Let's take a look at some of these highlights. First, the Brainbuster DDT. He drops it right in the skull, but it's not enough to land it to secure a three count. It's very early in the match. There was a lot more action to come. We saw these two lunatics diving off the top rope to the floor. Nobody's hitting anything. Nobody's in the pool. It's an even contest all the way around. Randy Stan pulls him up straight from the Brainbuster into a powerbomb. Again, down across the neck. The offense focused directly on the head of Ricky the Dragon Steamboat. Trying to just make the best, you know, just knock the man unconscious for 3 damn seconds. And he struggled the whole match. Even employing some dirty tactics that he learned. You guarantee he learned that from Prince Awesome. Just a feet across the ropes, doing everything you can. You know, just sneak the win, cheat the win, steal the win. You know, if he had learned to lie in there somewhere, he'd have the trifecta. It just wasn't enough. But then it was the finality of the frog splash. Finally was enough to overcome the dragon. And with that three count, Ricky the Dragon Steamboat is sent home. Randy Stan is going to move on to the second round of the tournament. One step closer to... Holy, what? Wait, what is... Is that 1990s Undertaker? What is this nonsense? Why is he attacking Randy Stan? Ricky, get in there! Say, you're supposed to be a good guy. Why are you leaving? I don't understand any of what's happening here. The Undertaker has made an appearance to attack Randy Stan after his match. Randy dodges the elbow, lands the enziguri, knocks the big man down. We got an entire extra fight on our hands. Uses a Northern Lights suplex, tips the big man over. Randy going to the top. If you're going to start a fight, you better be able to finish it, old man. Well, I guess you're not old yet. In Randy's time, the Undertaker is just a crumbling husk of a man. But now, he's young, in his prime. Randy, top rope, missile drop kick to the chest. But it won't keep the big man down. Tries it again. Flying butt sandwich. And that is to put the Undertaker on his face. But Randy is exhausted. He just had that incredible matchup with Ricky the Dragon Steamboat. He doesn't have a ton left. He's gotta get rid of this guy. Tosses him outside the ring. Shoulder block to the gut. And that's going to be enough to convince the Undertaker that he doesn't want any piece of Randy Stan. Maybe. All right, moving past that, we're set up for our third match of the night. The Great Prince Awesome is taking on Bret the Hitman Hart. Yeah. In our current timeline, the Great Prince Awesome is a big fan of Bret the Hell. Oh, no. How did Prince Awesome... Wait, why does he have... Bret the Hitman Hart is the current Intercontinental Champion. How did Prince Awesome get the belt? Where did he get that jacket? Is that... It looks very... Did he steal Bret Hart's jacket? And Intercontinental title? What is Prince Awesome thinking? There is no way that this isn't going to be answered. He's stolen the Intercontinental title and the jacket of Bret the Hitman Hart. This, you, I don't know what the game plan is here. Or is he trying to antagonize the Hitman? Just that it seems a little over the top. It seems a little bit more than he should be doing. I mean, I'm all for sparking a good rivalry, but that seems, this is taking it too far. Bret has acquired a replacement jacket. Prince Awesome, not waiting around, hops out of the ring, and he's already looking for a weapon. Dude, I don't know what got said between these two. Prince Awesome testing out that baseball bat he found. He said Bret better keep his eyes in front of him. Prince Awesome runs up and bat to the throat and to the ribs and to the ribs again. He can't even get on his feet. Prince Awesome finally has enough, smashes him in the with an elbow to the face. So right out here in front of our crowd, hooks him up with a tiger suplex onto the steel steps. What? I don't know what's gotten into the great Prince Awesome tonight, but he is having absolutely none of this nonsense from Bret Hart. Now it could be. We know that Prince Awesome and Big Hamm, they have been known to be friends in the past. Now it could be. The Prince Awesome took exception to Bret Hart looking to interfere in Big Ham's matchup earlier tonight. But this seems like kind of an outside-the-box retribution. This is more than just getting even for coming down to the ring to support your tag partner. Prince Awesome is making a statement here against Bret Hart. Now, it could be argued, as he uses the Dragon Sleeper to cause Bret Hart to have to tap out. Well, there's no referee. This match is not started, by the way. They've never even made it into the ring. See, this is just a mugging outside the ring. But the point I was trying to make is you got to believe that Prince Awesome is doing this as a statement to Big Hamm, a statement of solidarity. Maybe knowing that Big Hamm is on his own now, maybe Prince Awesome looking for a little extra backup. Now, he does have his own tag team partner, but it never hurts to have extra friends. And if Prince Awesome is doing all this, he's doing all this to the great Bret Hart as a sign of friendship. Ooh, that friendship is going to be bathed in blood. No, Bret Hart avoids the chair shot, does not avoid the second one, takes it directly between the shoulder blades, and then he ducks the knee shot. Then takes it to the face. No, Bret, you have to escape. Now, oh, pissed off Canadian Grandpa gets to his feet. Gets his head smashed in the ring post. And then into the security guardrail. Hiro Hamada cannot get control of this thing. This match, they're throwing it out. That's impossible, improbable. But we're going to get it restarted. Hiro Hamada gets these two inside the ring. We're going to get this match going. Because this is a tournament. This is a tournament for the $10,000 cash prize. We have to have a winner in every single round. So even though the first match is thrown out, we're going to get this thing restarted, get these two in the ring, and see if we can get a winner. We get the great Prince Awesome going one-on-one with Bret the Hitman Hart in a first-round contest that has so far failed to get on track at least already once. We've at least got them in the ring. We got the bell rung. So whatever happens now, we can work to a finish. So Bret, using his technical mastery to counter the quick offense of Great Prince Awesome, keeping him grounded, working the elbow, using it, cranking that neck right there. So Prince Awesome uses the shoulder block, kind of return the favor. He's got a little bit of a size advantage. He might try to express that, use the butterfly underhooks and a float over suplex. He snatches Bret to about halfway up his feet. Sinks him in. Throws the arm over. Good vertical suplex. Right near the ropes, though, so no cover. Prince Awesome hops down to the floor. What's he thinking about here? Grabs Bret by the neck. He tries to suplex him out of the ring to the floor. It's a first-round matchup, guys. Everyone is going so hard tonight. There is no mercy in any of our LBW competitors. And Bret Hart, looking to make a... uses the crucifix, drives Prince Awesome down across his neck. Clearly, gentlemen, that lack of mercy goes both ways. Great with the chin lock, got his knees straight across the lumbar. And tosses Prince Awesome down on his back. Referee is still counting, by the way. This is not, and I want to point out to our fans watching home tonight, this is not no disqualification. This is not false count anywhere. These two are supposed to be inside that ring. I have no idea what has gotten in the way, what's in the Kool-Aid tonight, but everyone is going super hardcore. So Hiro Hamada continues the count. See, suplex outside the ring. And they've been counted out. This match ends in a draw. We can't have that.
Confusing and make him angry. Bright man. He likes when things work out. Oh, no. Oh, no. Oh, and he's locked him into the accolades. Sorted out here. Male, sorted. Yeah, you get the jokes. Oh, whoa. Dangerous mission. You get the feeling Bacon, yep, Bacon's done with this. Stump puller pile driver, that. That indomitable spirit, this kid's got a heart, but he's also got a face full of ring posts.
Okay, so we got a ruling. We got a ruling from our general manager, who is on vacation this week, but she's watching the show live. She texted me during the commercial break and let me know that she's gonna have Hiro Hamada restart the match again for the third time, because there has to be a victor. There cannot be a draw. There cannot be a no contest. We need to have a victor here. So she's going to restart this matchup for the third time, and as many times as it takes until these two can settle their differences and get us a winner. So, we join the match in progress. Yeah, it's like Prince Awesome using the duck around German suplex. Trying to get some offensive pressure going. He catches Brett running past him with the release German suplex again. Apparently, Germany is the hard counter to Canada. Who would have known? Who would have imagined? The Panzer tanks beat waffles and syrup any day. Brett's Awesome lands the elbow to the spine. Lands it again. Trying to take away some of the power from Bret Hart. But that technical acumen. He's so quick. He's so young. Prince Awesome managed to counter the neck breaker into one of his own. Stops Brett from spinning around on him. Taken to the top rope. Beautiful turning moonsault. And he gets his feet on the ropes. Handful of tights. But it's not enough. It's not enough to stop Bret Hart, who is incredulous, but Prince Awesome uses that time to land a turning heel kick to the face. Goes to swing again. Brett dodges the kick and counters the beautiful backdrop. Gets Prince Awesome on the mask, counters with the jawbreaker. Trying to keep Brett stunned, dizzy, off his game. Because if Bret Hart can get his feet underneath him and slow the pace of this matchup down, he will dissect Prince Awesome or anybody else who gets in that ring. And Prince Awesome knows this. So he's using the Dragon Sleeper right now, trying to work on that neck, crank the neck backwards. He actually used this move during the first part of this contest when they were fighting outside the ring to get an impromptu submission, but it didn't matter because the match had never officially started. I think he's trying to go back to that well. You know, right now he's getting the top of his head caved in with that hard elbow. So Brett pulls him in, goes for the pile driver. Prince Awesome sees it coming and counters it. Yanks Brett to his feet, but gets pulled into a DDT. So Bret Hart is one of the craftiest competitors we have here in I'd love to say that we have here in OBW. He's a guest at this point. Unfortunately, you know, since we're visiting here in 1994, when we go back, when we use the flux travel device and go back to our current timeline, Brett's going to be a bit of an older man, not going to be able to compete at this level. So it's really a treat that we get to see him here tonight. So Prince Awesome feels the sharpshooter coming and is able to kick Brett away. And so Brett sees it coming, smacks Prince Awesome in the back of the head, and then whips him into the corner. Hard chop to the chest. So yeah, Prince Awesome needs a break after that. You don't get those meat flaps smack like that and just recover from it instantly. He uses the shoulder block takedown. He's running around, looking to land that stomp. Doesn't hit it. Gets sucker punched in the mouth instead. And a nice snapping back body drop. So you got to believe, Brett's looking for a kill here. He steps through, turns those legs. He's going to turn Prince Awesome directly into the sharpshooter. Center of the ring. And Prince Awesome, he's a crafty guy. He's able to fight it off before it does too much damage. So Brett might have gone for the sharpshooter without most of the setup he normally goes through. But the Bulldog out of the corner. Now you might be looking for a win a different way. The sharpshooter didn't get it. Bret Hart has he's known for having a nasty pile driver too. When the sharpshooter can't do it, sometimes he'll wrestle a guy whose legs are too thick, back's too strong. Have to use something else. Normally he'll go to that pile driver instead if the sharpshooter isn't working. And since Prince Awesome got out of it once already, that might be what he's thinking about here. Prince Awesome fires back with the right hand, still gets whipped into the corner. So Brett stacks him up onto the top rope. Look at a little woozy on his feet. It's a game plan here. Kicks those feet out to the side. Might be looking for something big. Climbs to the top rope himself. Top. No. Top rope suplex. Superplex. So Bret Hart on his feet. Gets his leg cut out from under him. Prince Awesome. He's got to be working on fumes right now. There's no way he knows what's going on. He's got dropped off the top rope. Prince Awesome hooks him up with the brainbuster. Drops him right on his head. And that calls out mid-2000s Undertaker. Did he get caught in the time warp too? Why? Why is Biker Taker here? Bret Hart gets curb stomped. He's out. Prince Awesome, too much to worry about. He's got Biker Taker outside the ring. He's got Bret down for the pin. Scores the pinfall. But he's still got to deal with Biker Taker. Looking at him funny. Let's get a look at these replays. It's a beautiful turning moonsault off the top rope. That was the beginning of the end for Bret Hart. That's kind of where the momentum began to shift. And Prince Awesome goes directly into a dirty pin. The referee, Hiro Hamada, doesn't see it. Doesn't notice the feet on the top rope, but Brett was able to kick out anyway. This would have been the pile driver that might have ended it for Bret Hart. Gets it countered. Brett lands that hard chop in the corner, but he falls to the brainbuster. And the brainbuster is a setup for the curb stomp. This is driving Brett to the ground in a delicate unconsciousness. And 3 seconds later, Hiro Hamada has a winner for you, and it's the great Prince Awesome. Now this does not explain what Biker Taker's doing here. Prince Awesome doesn't need your help. He runs out, drops Biker Taker on his face with a quick German suplex. He's trying to figure out what's going on. He's beset on all sides by enemies. He whips Biker Taker into the Spanish announce table down there. Yeah, I mean we simulcast. It's important. You gotta be bilingual for the kids. Prince Awesome, not caring about the kids right now. Lands another deep German suplex on Biker Taker. Oh, man, big Evil's not feeling it. He should have minded his own damn business. The gist that I'm gonna read, he's not fighting Prince Awesome back. Prince Awesome just lashing out for no reason. I think Undertaker came down to the ring in a different costume tonight, as a different man, to show his younger self how to interfere, and it just backfired on his face. Bret Hart was a non-factor. He was down the entire beating that was getting laid on the Undertaker. All right, now that we're all calmed down after that last barn burner, let's get into what I believe is going to be a much more one-sided contest. It's going to be Big Money Buck Cashman taking on Big Daddy Cool Diesel. Now, there was ever one of these first-round matchups that you had to believe wasn't going to go the way of modern, wasn't going to go modern LBW's way. It's going to be big money, Buck Cashman getting past Big Daddy Cool Diesel, former heavyweight champion. In this time, he's the one of the, you know, one of the most successful competitors they have going right now. It's gonna be, you gotta believe it's gonna be a walk in the park for the 7 foot, you know, with a 7 foot tall 300 pounder. I mean, he's an angry trucker, and Buck Cashman doesn't really seem like he's gonna be able to buy his way out of this one. I mean, knowing what we know about Kevin Nash, that might be on the table in a couple of years. But you figure at this point, Diesel's pretty well paid. The pocketbook's not going to come into play right here. So, yeah, look at that. Look at this guy. He's so young, so hairy. His quads still work. His legs aren't all torn to pieces. His back's not shredded. He hasn't dropped a giant on his neck yet. He hasn't started hanging out with Scott Hall and become a complete adult degenerate. Yeah, the world's tallest 15-year-old. Hasn't happened yet. So not an issue, not a factor. So Big Daddy Cool Diesel, still a cool guy. Still one of this announcer's personal favorites around this time. He's too tall, he's too tall, he's too cool. I didn't even figure out Liz wasn't tall. Thought he was a truck-based guy. No, yeah, giant trucker named Diesel, the kind of fuel the trucks use. You know, it's starting to put it all together. He's got the sashes, he's got the leather. He's a cool, tall, cool, disaffected guy. So Buck Cashman, he's given up almost a foot and a half of height and close to 100 pounds of what's just muscle. Let's see what Buck can pull off here. He gets a running start and just jams that elbow in. He's just throwing rabbit punches everywhere. He's smashing the big man in the mouth. Doesn't seem to be moving him a whole lot. He's still trying. That's 7 or 8 unanswered punches from Buck Cashman. Yeah, he goes low, goes to the legs, throws him into the corner, sprints in and runs head first into the middle turnbuckle. Gets spun right around. Using that speed, but he's got nothing in the power game. That's where it's gonna work down and work against him. So he's going second rope, lands the elbow to the face. So Buck is officially out of this thing. Just go ahead and pin him. Call this a short night. And send Diesel to the second round. So Buck unable to get back to his feet. And Big Daddy Cool is just kind of picking at him. So up there, Buck wrenches that arm, yanks him to the ground. And this swinging backbreaker into the side Russian leg sweep. Buck got some sweet tech out here. He's trying to make a go of this thing. Backbreaker, leg sweep combo again. It worked once, you try it twice. Buck off the ropes. He's running in, the head of steam, elbow to the chest. Oh, he's ready. He's feeling it. So Buck Cashman looking for the upset of the century. Got the man on his shoulders, drops him into the Falcon Arrow, climbs across that big body for the pin. Using all of his body weight to hold that leg up, but it's not enough. Doesn't even get him a long two count. Kind of short, kind of quick, kind of body slam to the mat. See Diesel charging up for the crowd. Buck, kick those little feet all you want to, buddy. You're catching a side slam tonight. Oh no, Diesel drops that boot across the nose. Can't believe he's gonna kick those glasses into the face of Buck Cashman. Why would you fight wearing them? His glasses. It seems silly, but apparently they help him see better. You know, like the functional glasses are supposed to do. Middle rope, elbow to the throat, keeps it rolling. It rolls him clear across to that side of the ring. So he tries it again. That's two. Is he going for a third? Misses the trifecta. He's able to get back to his feet. And Buck counting to those right hands again. He's just, oddly enough, Buck Cashman turning this thing into a slugfest. He uses the power of Doofy White Guy dancing to punch Diesel square in the jaw. Pulls him up again. He's got him turned around. Lands that Falcon Arrow a second time. Gonna try for the pin again. Hoists that big leg up there. And it's a long two count. Well, Buck's getting frustrated, but you know, you gotta think, that was closer than the first time, Buck. You headed in the right direction. Now, I don't mind being proven wrong, but I kinda would have bet the farm that Diesel wouldn't have let this go for more than 2 minutes. And my boy is kinda failing me here. I don't mind saying, I'm gonna be out a few dollars if Diesel can't turn that smash right fist into a jackknife powerbomb and put away Buck Cashman. I'm gonna be eating, you know, ramen noodles for a little bit. I may have had a dollar or two on this thing. And I definitely wasn't betting on Buck. But Buck counters the jackknife. He counters the jackknife powerbomb. What is happening? What is life right now? The jaw, like the sit-out jawbreaker. What is going on? Is Buck Cashman, honestly, the momentum, the crowd is on his side. Was Diesel, he's reeling up on the shoulders again for the third time. Falcon Arrow, center of the ring. Buck snatches that big leg. And Diesel can't answer the, he can't answer the bell, and I am going to be eating, oh my God, no, the rent money. Baby needed new shoes, and I bet against Buck. And Diesel, you failure. You know what? Good. I'm looking forward to you ripping your quads apart. You deserve everything that happens to you. A curse on you. A pox on your family. Oh, Buck Cashman's your winner. He took three Falcon Arrows. The second couldn't get it done. The third lands it. You hoist that big leg up, and Buck Cashman is moving on to the second round of the $10,000 tournament, and putting down Big Daddy Cool Diesel in the greatest upset in the history of our sport, and possibly the bankrupting of H-Panic 22. Just, I don't know what else to say. Buck Cashman's your winner. All right, get buckled in for the semifinals in our second round of our Cash Money Tournament. Let's see who's going to take home a pocket full of money. It's a long day sitting in a stiff chair, watching hard-hitting action. My man, Big Hamm, making his second appearance tonight after dismantling Jim the Anvil Neidhart in the first round. You're not going to see many. None of our other first-round matches went. Are going to go into the books with such a short runtime. It might be the shortest match in LBW history, technically speaking, from bell to bell. The actual, what's going in the record books is match starts, Big Hamm lands a meat squasher, Big Hamm catches a three count, show's over. Now, what actually happened is your boy ambushed Jim the Anvil Neidhart during his entrance and beat the tar stuffing out of him up and down the entranceway, tossed him in the ring, and closed this thing out. That kind of aggression is going to lend Big Hamm maybe an advantage here going forward. He's taking on Rowdy Randy Stan, who is not known for being a physical monster. You know, Big Ham's going to look to use that power, that aggressive stance. And the other thing that's going to factor into it, you want to look at the two kinds of matches that Big Hamm and Randy Stan had leading up to this. Big Hamm had a very short night so far. He ran out, he came out to the ring and utterly dominated his opponent and ended his match as quickly as possible. Rowdy Randy Stan, he took on Ricky the Dragon Steamboat in a fantastic contest of athleticism and high-flying daring. Just the beating he put on himself in that contest, is that going to factor into this later? Is that going to influence? Is that going to influence this matchup at all? That, you know, does Randy Sand have anything left? Does he have enough left in the tank to get past the onslaught that is going to come from Big Ham? And we're going to find out right now. Randy Sand immediately ducks out of the ring. He's going to take a breather. Make the big man chase him around. He's looking for some help. And pulls a table out from underneath the ring. Big Ham's having no part of that. Randy Sand lands a jawbreaker. Gets tossed off. Like I said, instead of going into this, if you got eyeballs, you can see the Big Ham's going to have a big size and weight advantage. Yeah, that's the second time Randy's moved in for it to try to get some of that grappling going, and it's been tossed on his butt. Now Big Ham's got the table. He just thumps Randy in the mouth with it. Jabs him in the ribs. Randy might come to regret the decision to pull the table out from underneath the ring. Doesn't seem to be doing him any favors right now. Hugs that ring post, looking for some. No. Just kisses it. Give it a hug, give it a kiss. Might as well send it some Valentine's Day flowers. He's able to get the foot up and get the spinning heel kick. Collects his table. Tries to use it against Big Ham. Who gets it bumped into his face. The table hasn't been set up yet, so it's not in any real danger of being destroyed yet. Now, worth pointing out, the match did actually start, but referee Hiro Hamada seems to be letting this go. He's not counting, so then unless there's a change in the rule book that I wasn't aware of, I wasn't hip to the fact this match is being contested under no disqualification rules. But apparently, we're going no countouts. No countouts, no DQs. Big Hamm, big counter into a Samoan drop. Teach a small man to run at you. You plant him in the ground like a tree. Big Hamm drops the elbow. He's just trying to get Randy Sand to get a little life back and wake him back up. Maybe no DQs, but you can't win outside the ring. Jeez. Big Hamm lays that elbow into the neck of Randy Sand. Picks up that foot, drives the foot down to the ground. It's a knee lock DDT. It just sends shockwaves all up through your body. So Randy Sand slides in. So Big Hamm right behind him. It's that toss to the corner turnbuckle. Now Big Hamm able to counter the grapple offense with a swift DDT. Looks Randy Sand up. The meat squasher. Right in the corner. Randy's tucked up into the ropes. Big Hamm rolls him even deeper. No rope breaks. Say Randy's got to get that shoulder off. He's got to get that shoulder off the mat. And he does. He gets away from the meat squasher the first time. But it has been all Big Hamm thus far. Randy Sand catches the foot, steps through, spinning heel kick to the face. If he's going to turn this thing around, he needs to get it going and get it going quick. Turn those hips. That's one. Doesn't release the hold. That's two. Whip those hips again. One, two, one amigo, two amigo, three amigos. So Randy, normally he looks for the frog splash after the three amigos. Not a lot of setup work on it. Can he get a pin? Can he get a pin? A quick pin. No, he can't steal one. There's been a lot of fire exchange between the two, and Randy is feeling confident himself. He's got a little room to gloat right here. So Big Hamm, he shoves his man off. Seems to have a second wind about him. Throws Randy in the opposite corner. So he stacks him on the top rope. Looking for something big. There's no good news that comes from a setup this high. Butterfly suplex off the top rope. Randy Sand can't get away from that. gets drugged to his feet. He's dazed. Kick to the hard kick to the torso. Spinning heel kick to the side of the head. Big Hamm is ready for a fight. He's all pumped up. Goes for a quick cover. No, that's not going to be enough. So Randy Stanton still had the wherewithal to kick out, even though he just got his insides turned into cream corn. He gets stocked up on the top rope again. Randy kicks him off this time. Counters with a flying missile drop kick to the face. And the momentum is quickly reversed. It's a big hand using that big shoulder block. He's waiting on him. Kick to the gut. Meat squasher again! Big Hamm lands the meat squasher. That's gotta be enough. But it's not. It's not. How is it not Big Hamm? Hey, I think Hamm is right. I think he should argue with the referee on that one. How did Randy Stanton get his arm up in time? How did he get that shoulder off the mat? Ooh. And he counters with a hard knee. Right to the chest. Tope calling Hilo over the top rope. Trying to get the crowd fired up. Get behind him. Takes a smash right to the face. Counters the go-behind. Standing switch. They're throwing fists, elbows. They're trying to get everything in there they can. Randy pulls that head in. Doesn't let go. He's trying for the three amigos. That's two. Can he get the third one? Does he have the strength left to land the third? And he does. He plants Big Hamm. It's a little off center. If he's got it in him to go for the frog splash, it's gonna be a turning one. He breaks that boot across the eye. Drop kick to the back of the head. And he heads outside the ring. He's looking for, you know, he tried the table in the early part of the matchup. He goes and gets himself a baseball bat. And applies the bat directly to the spine. And then drops it outside the ring. He just needed a little bit of extra leverage. Big Hamm kicks the eye away from him. Oh, Randy's in dazed, but he gets the arm drag off. Can't see what he's doing, but knows enough to do that. Twisting. Randy Stanton pulls him down. Not enough. Big Hamm able to kick himself away. The Big Hamm. Randy, kick to the gut. Throws the arm over. Lifting brainbuster suplex. Drops him straight into the mat. So Randy, what are you going to do? You've got the upper hand right now. He's feeling it. He's got the crowd behind him. The running drop kick. Blood from a stone. Randy. No. Oh, kick to the hard kick to the chest. Thought he was going to go for the dick shot there. It's a Big Hamm. Not a fan. Brad busted him open. Might have just been the get up and go he needed. Twist that leg. Drop that weight right across that knee. They twist him up. You know, so Big Hamm switching tactics. He's a ring general in there. He's got a lot left in the tank. But there's not a plan in place here. Oh no, the plan is just to mash. Just a mash Randy stand down. And hard kicks to the chest. Follows him with a roundhouse to the head. And he's got time to show off with the crowd because he is feeling this one. This is looking locked up for Big Hamm. If Rowdy Randy Stanton was going to pull off some of that reversal magic, it needs to happen now. So he catches Big Hamm running in, catches him in the corner. Going to take this opportunity. And Big Hamm rolls the wrong way, tries to get out of the ring, rolls himself into a frog splash. Ooh, and the two count is all Randy can get. He does not believe it. Big Hamm made a minor error, tried to roll himself out of the ring, rolled further into it. And gets himself frog splashed again. Randy turning the opposite direction. And that's enough. That'll do it. It takes two frog splashes in a row. Randy's able to reverse the momentum. Let's look at these highlights. The early action. The match, as soon as the match gets started, Big Hamm throwing heavy leather, drops him with the meat squasher in the corner. See, Randy able to get the Three Amigos suplex off and lands the first of three frog splashes it takes to keep Big Hamm down. See, the first one doesn't work. Second one doesn't work. Third time's a charm. And Big Hamm is finally felled. Randy Stan moves on to the finals of the cash tournament. He's gonna take on the winner of our next matchup in a ladder match to decide who gets the briefcase full of money. Coming up next, it's the underdog of the night, Big Money Buck Cashman, taking on Prince Awesome and his beautiful valet, Summer Rae. Now, we've had some interesting matches tonight, and really, we had none more unexpected, is probably the best word I can think of, than Buck Cashman being able to take out Big Daddy Cool Diesel in the first round. Now, of all the ways you could have thought that would go, getting jackknifed over the top rope, getting jackknifed through a table, getting jackknifed through the center of the ring, getting jackknifed into orbit, none of the ways that I had it ending had Buck Cashman coming out with the pin. Didn't see it coming. Listen, lost a ton of money on the deal. Not that gambling on professional fighting is anything that you should be doing, especially not when you work for the company. These are issues for another day. Point is, Buck Cashman earned his spot, and he's going to take on the great Prince Awesome, who was able to secure the managerial services of the lovely Summer Rae. Now, we don't see Summer very often. We love to have her when we can. She's got a very busy schedule of just being amazing elsewhere. But when she can make it down to LBW, she likes to hang out with her boy Prince Awesome. That's it. She's proven invaluable in the past with her, let's call it, unique style of management. Likes to get involved. It adds an extra layer for Prince Awesome's opponents. They have to, one, ignore the fact that she's pretty, and two, they have to get around the fact that she is very creative in finding ways to help her man win. Now, our hero, your hero, the great Prince Awesome, is going to be looking to steamroll right past Buck Cashman and stop that lucky streak before it has a chance to really go anywhere. And Prince Awesome trying to demonstrate early that he is the bigger man in this ring. Picks Buck up by the face, snaps him by the belt, snaps him over with the suplex. You see the size differential. Now, you don't think of Prince Awesome as a very large man because he's usually in there with guys who are much bigger than he is. But he is towering over Buck. Snaps him, throws him with the suplex again. Just muscles him over. He's got about 6 inches of height, probably a good 70, a good 40, 50 pounds of muscle over Buck Cashman. Buck is scrappy, if nothing else. The guy, he's a fighter. He's in there trying to win, make a name for himself. Takes a running heel kick to the mouth, though. You see the way Prince Austin even makes the cover. Puts that hand across the mouth. Turns that head sideways. He's not letting the kid breathe. See, a hard German suplex on top of the head. He bends the elbow and stomps on the fingers. So he bends the elbow, turns the fingers backwards, stomps on the bottom of the elbow. It overflexes the entire hand. So Prince Awesome yanks him up and down on the brainbuster. This could be an early night for Prince Awesome, but doesn't go for the cover. He's taunting the boy to his feet. Buck Cashman is in a world of trouble right now. Up and down with the Death Valley driver. Now he's going to go for the cover. Well, it was a good run, Cinderella, but it's not over yet, Buck Cashman. Look, I'm not going to put any more money on this fight. I know better than to bet against Buck Cashman. Frankly, He cleaned me out. I had no idea that was coming. But it's not looking good for the kid right now. He's in there with the great Prince Awesome, one of the early favorites to win the LBW Heavyweight Title Tournament. Lost via upset there. And that belly-to-belly suplex, he's trying to make this crowd into a believer so that they never doubt him again. Now, your hero lands a beautiful Northern Lights. Doesn't go for the cover there, looking to dish out a little bit of punishment. Hops the top rope, trying to taunt his man into standing up. Looks a little too close. Prince Awesome wildly overshoots. I'm not even sure what the hell that was supposed to be. But before Buck can even recover, he takes a clothesline to the back of the head. Yes, everything your hero does isn't going to work out. Is there Buck not so dizzy that he can't land the Enziguri counter? Oh, look at that. A little bit of payback from Cashman. Yeah. Nice stomp on those knuckles. If nothing else, Buck is learning while he's in the ring. That wasn't something we've ever seen from him before, but it might be something he keeps in the repertoire now. He's taunting Prince Austin to his feet. Snatches him up. Is he going to use the Death Valley driver? No. Falcon Arrow. One. No. No three count for that. No three count for Buck Cashman. It's a little bit too early for that. So the Prince whips him into the corner. Stacks him up backwards, though. No good can come from this. And a slap to the spine. There's a Buck trying to run away, and he can't. Gets German suplexed off the top rope. Thrown three quarters of the way across the ring. And the Prince is just, he's just taunting. He's having a good time in there. Not even broken a sweat yet. You see the lovely Summer Rae on the outside, just willing her man to succeed. Oh, and Buck gets yanked up into the lion tamer. That knee, the right knee of Prince Awesome is pulled across the neck of Buck Cashman. As he bent in half, Buck gets away from it. How much damage did he get? He was stuck in that for a while. How much damage did it actually get it? And then the Death Valley driver again. Oh, Buck. Oh, just pin him. Pin him and be done with it. And Buck kicks out. That's got to be more heart. This is a case of more heart than brains. Buck doesn't know when to quit. But he nails it. He pulls the arm drag counter off. He might have a little more than we thought. Backbreaker into the side rushing leg sweep. We saw him use that combination move against Big Daddy Cool Diesel. Say, Buck, oh, you need to stay on it. I know you're feeling it. I know you want to get the crowd behind you. But this isn't the time to lollygag. You got the great Prince Awesome Dizzy. You need to capitalize. Jay Hard whip to the turnbuckle. Hard clothesline. Knocks him clean out. Drags Prince Awesome to his feet. He's dizzy. Shoots him off the ropes. Drop toe hold. Brings him straight down in front of his manager, who does not look amused. And a snapping DDT whips him right over. But see, this is the benefit of Summer Rae. She messes with the turnbuckle, gets the attention of Hiro Hamada. Now, Hamada's not paying attention to what's going on in the ring. That gives Prince Awesome a valuable few seconds to recover. But he pulls him. Buck pulls him straight into a Falcon Arrow. It might not be enough. Quick count. And Summer pulls Hamada out of the ring, breaking up the count. What? What is going on? Summer Rae arguing with the official. Prince Awesome recovers. No, it's not over. It's not over. So Buck Cashman is on the south side of a good deal here. There's Summer Rae pulling the referee out of the room, messing with the turnbuckle, pulls the referee out of the ring, doing some top quality work, ensuring that her client has all the advantages necessary. Doesn't seem like he needs them. Prince Awesome yanks him back up into the lion tamer again. Oh, Buck is bent in half like a pretzel. He's center of the ring. No ropes anywhere nearby. And Buck has to tap out. There is no way out of that. Let's take a look at these replays. I think, Prince Awesome lands the brainbuster early in the match, followed directly by the Death Valley driver. Now, to his credit, Buck Cashman was able to get his shoulders off the mat and keep this match going. No one really thought he was going to go get that far. But then he started to turn the tide. He lands a snapping DDT, the Falcon Arrow, for the long two count. He found himself stuck in the Lion Tamer the first time. And, you know, you would have thought he figured a way out of it because he was able to escape it this time. He had enough gas left in the tank to get his feet over the first time. But by the time he got caught in a second, he just didn't have anything left. But Cashman cashes out. Prince Awesome moves on to meet Rowdy Randy Stan in the finals of this Cash Money tournament in a ladder match in our main event tonight.
Good evening. My name is Whitey Panic, and I'm the general manager of Low Budget Wrestling. While I'm disappointed that I could not take the trip back to 1994, I did send along a special contract for our champion, R. Sean Wells. I had scheduled him to compete in a non-title match that he demanded to defend his championship against someone who'd been calling him out for the last month, Rip the Ladies' Man Sexton. Unfortunately, Rip is still suspended. But I made him a new deal. Take the match and the title opportunity tonight at OVW 94 and prove everyone wrong. But lose and be banished from Low Budget Wrestling permanently. Guess which one he picked.
I don't even know what to say to this. I'm so excited. Our general manager has given Rip Sexton, finally given him his opportunity with a one-on-one match for the Low Budget Wrestling Heavyweight Championship. It's really gonna happen. Rip has finally made the deal he was looking for this entire time. He's got a chance to prove that he's the rightful champion. And R. Sean Wells can silence him once and for all by not only beating him and closing the chapter on the title match, but putting him out of the company indefinitely. This is for everything right now. And it starts off clubbing blow from R. Sean Wells. Not in the mood to play games with Rip Sexton tonight. So this really is going to be Rip's miraculous victory. He's going to need to get going. That's a hard shoulder, twist the arm, and a good shoulder block. So Rip looking for an advantage here. Goes right outside the ring looking for a weapon. So he finds himself a steel chair underneath the ring. Arshon takes it from him, throws it clean out of his hands. He's not going to give Rip the chance to get an equalizer. A nice, good hard drop, good suplex to the right to the mat. It's a rip counters with a fantastic clothesline to the throat, goes right back to the steel chair. He clearly came in here with a game plan, knows that this match is no disqualification. Knows he did that chair shot to the face is legal as a headlock. And let it never be said that Rip Sexton was too proud to take a shortcut. He couldn't get it done last week in his tag team match. this week, you gotta believe he has every intention of doing everything he can, tossing the big man into the guardrail once, twice, a third time. Just a headbutt to the face. He's a shot to the gut where he gets finally thrown off. Arshon shoves him down again. It's like watching little brother try to fight with big brother until big brother doesn't want to have it anymore. But Rip is going to have to do everything in his power to make the most of this opportunity. Every time he gets unseated here and Arshon can get this big, can lay that big powerful offense in, it's going to work against him. Rip throws his man back into the ring and gets countered again. Just staying on the gas pedal is going to be probably the hardest part of this whole thing. Arshon spins him in the corner, hard kick to the stomach. Throws it down. Arshon goes for the cannonball in the corner and misses. He's injured and he looks like he might have hurt his back a little bit. He's feeling pretty confident. He's got enough time to go ahead and taunt a little bit instead of running out and stopping Rip from looking for another weapon. Arshon wraps him up, snap suplex on the mat outside the ring. So you see, and as much as I talk about Rip needing to stay on the gas pedal, Arshon Wells has not let up since this match started. You see, Rip's been able to sneak in a bit of offense here, a bit of offense there. Those hard right hand shots, he's used the steel chair. You see, now he's got the big man on the ground. So you keep him down there when he's close to your feet. Everybody's the same size when they're laying on your back. Rip Sexton is making use of that right now, and he's looking for another advantage. He finds himself a kendo stick under the ring. And, oh, no. He's taking it to the gut. Arshon blocks it, but gets yanked down into the backbreaker. So Rip grabs a handful of that thick, lustrous hair of Arshon Wells, uses it to yank him down into the backbreaker, and spikes him with a deep six. Not enough for a three count yet. So Rip looking confused, like he doesn't know, what happened. Come on, man, you gotta believe that's not enough to keep the champion down. Hard snapmare takeover. Kick to the spine, just seems to have woken the big man up. Arshon whipped into the corner. Catches that foot, clubbing forearm in the face. So the mustache does nothing to protect. And that high dropping knee dropped that 560 pound frame down across the chest. So Rip snaps that shoulder off the mat. Okay, keeping it moving, keep it going. So we've seen steel chairs, we've seen kendo sticks. See, Rip says unable to slow down the charge just yet. Arshon springboard dropkick, kinda whiffs. He overshoots his man. Looks like I thought he grazed him, but it looks like Riff was able to dodge it with the power of standing perfectly still. Like a T-Rex. If he doesn't move, he can't see you. Arshon throws him off. He's back in for the grab. Knee to the face. Nothing fancy about that. Twisting. Oh, German suplex straight down. You get a guy that fast to be agile enough to get around you that quick. Goes for a cover here. And Rip has to kick out again. Rip has to throw that weight off that chest. It burns up a lot of energy. And Arshon just plants that fist in the side of the head. That helmet of hairspray and machismo is not doing a whole lot to protect Rip right now. Rip drug to his feet. Tuck that arm under. Pump handle. Neck breaker. Oh, no. No, that's usually the set. It's usually the a sign that Arshon Wells is... He's about to pick up the offense, drives that big knee straight in the lower back. Rip able to get to his feet and bring that thigh straight up into the mouth. Arshon Wells create a little separation. Only picks him halfway up to his knee. He can land a solid punch in the mouth again. Boom! What the hell was that? He just flipped Arshon Wells upside down. He pulled something from the tights. But it's not enough. It's not enough. See, we have instant replay here in OVW? Is that a rule? Can we do that? And the deep six again. Center of the ring. This is it. This is Rip's time to shine. And Arshon Wells kicks out again. when the foreign object smacked in the face, the steel chair earlier, the kendo stick that never really got used. Arson is weathering the storm of all of Rip's, let's call it unconventional offense. And he steals the deep six. He hits Rip with his own finisher. And whoa, is not enough. You want to talk about an embarrassing way to lose the title match you've been clamoring for over a month. You get hit with your own finisher in the center of the ring and then get beat. Getting stripes ripped off your body with the kendo stick that you brought into the ring. Rip might be the signature of his own demise here. A quick back body drop, looking for a sneaky pin. It's not enough. It's not enough. They're on their feet. Rip, he needs something. He's got to get it going. Okay, Arson goes for the duck behind. Rip counters with the elbow. Rips Arson Wells into the corner. Come on, Rip, you need something, buddy. The brain chop's not going to be enough. Arson counters again. Rip, smash right. Go behind, standing switch. Elbow to the back of the head. Picks him up, cradle like a baby, teardrop swinging suplex. Rip doesn't know where he is, but Arshaw may have spent too much gas in that last sequence of counter after counter. Cannot capitalize. See, Rip's been down for almost, you know, a count of 15, 20, count to 100, but Arshaw too exhausted in that moment to capitalize. Rip, the jawbreaker, gets an arm pushed down, elbow countered back and forth. Arson goes to the headbutt, gets it countered again with another jawbreaker. Rip goes to the pocket, tries to grab the foreign object. Arson snatches him up into the Samoan. No, it's all going bad for Rip. Rip, come on, buddy. Don't get pump handled. Gets pump handled, neck broken again. And now Arson Wells is willing. Rip Sexton to his feet, kick to the gut, thrown off the ropes. 10 feet high, pop-up powerbomb. Rip Sexton is pinned. Rip Sexton has been pinned and is now suspended indefinitely. Arson Wells has successfully defended the LBW Heavyweight Championship against Rip Sexton. Against that beautiful deep six. Arson landing the giant knee across the chest. And this match from beginning to end was just offense from both parties. The champion pulling out everything he had to withstand the, let's call a spade, the cheating of Rip Sexton. This from the steel chair to the, from the steel chair from outside the ring to the kendo stick to whatever that was in his tights. It all ends with a pop-up powerbomb and a 1-2-3. Arson Wells is victorious in this, his first successful LBW title defense. He sends Rip Sexton off to somewhere. He's gone. Rip Sexton is out of here. What will the committee have to say about this? And we still got our main event. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the main event of the evening. Rowdy Randy Stan meets the great Prince Awesome in a ladder match for a briefcase filled with $10,000.
Get low, 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 get low
general manager are performers. If you make it to the main event, you're allowed to use your actual theme music. So we got to see the revised entrances for our two main competitors tonight. So Prince Awesome went and got back in the jacket he stole from Brett the Hitman Hart earlier in the evening. And immediately, they both head outside the ring and start brawling near near our Spanish announce table. So Randy Stan grabs a ladder, and he's gonna do what he's gonna throws it into the ring instead of trying to use it as a weapon. Prince Awesome runs behind the man, side rushing leg sweep on the hard, hard, unforgiving, cold, concrete ground. I don't know. I mean, I don't know what they made the ground out of. I assume it's concrete. There's like a little pad over top of it, so it doesn't matter. Oh my God! Randy Stan whipped into the ropes and catches a flying one-footed drop kick to the mouth. So the members of Equipo Leon Negro, one of the dominant tag teams here in LBW, coming to blows over some money. Now you gotta believe it's more. As Randy Stan hangs Prince Awesome over the guardrail. You gotta believe it's professional rivalry, more so than personal. There's no bad blood here. These are two fantastic competitors who both, you know, are just seeing opportunity to gain an accolade. This is another thing to put on your resume. It's an invitational tournament winner, and you get $10,000 to spend. So that will buy you a lot of knee tassels. So Prince Awesome, Randy Stan is still brawling outside the ring. Randy Stan chucked inside. So he's able to land a quick arm drag counter. Prince Awesome flips him over. Dragon Sleeper DDT. Now, you gotta wonder, like, this has been a long one-night tournament, so all these matches have happened in the space of, you know, inside this hour you've been watching. There's that, and it doesn't give our competitors a lot of time to recover. So, you know, the wear and tear. Randy Stan has had some of the most brutal matchups of the night, and eats the brain buster from his mentor. He's groggy. Groggy rolls to one side, trying to get out of the ring. Doesn't quite have the energy to muster it. But how much is my point being, how much is left in the tank? How much does Randy Stan have left? So he saw his protracted aerial encounter with Ricky the Dragon Steamboat and a Death Valley driver from the... Why? There's so much. Randy Stan, come on, Randy, get to your feet. Don't make it easy for Prince Awesome. So Prince Awesome, top of the ladder, already going for the briefcase. Already looking to pull the money down and make a quick night of this. Randy jumping shot to the butt. You see the forearm to the hamstrings. He's able to dislodge his mentor. Give him a chance to sneak up underneath him. Powerbomb off the ladder. So that's gonna slow him down. That's gonna slow Prince Awesome down a little bit. He's groggy, trying to get to his feet. Gets flying dropkicked off the top rope from the springboard. So Randy putting together some good offense of his own, gonna take his shot at pulling the briefcase down. Prince Awesome only slightly dazed, gonna climb the ladder from the other side. And a hard shot to the gut. Randy not letting go, refusing to let go of that briefcase until he just can't hang on anymore. Takes a chop to the face, falls 10 to 15 feet from the ladder. Prince Awesome, top of the ladder. What's he looking to do? Holy shit! 450 splash off the ladder. Randy Stan might be in a coma. He might be dead. He might be knocked into a different dimension. We might have to leave his carcass here in 1994 because Prince Awesome just 450 splashed him off the top of a ladder. Randy, by the grace of some evil deity, has climbed to his feet just in time to see his mentor secure the briefcase and take the $10,000 prize. Just that is just unbelievable. Let's look at the highlights here. The Brainbuster. The Death Valley Driver. These are, it's just icing on the cake. It's enough to slow Randy Stan down. Just enough for Prince Awesome to secure the briefcase from on top of the ladder. The 450 splash was just, that was the final nail. That right there, that's your winner of LBW 94. Have a good night, everybody. We'll see you back next week in 2018.